Tom Peterson will be missed, but certainly not forgotten by all Siouxlanders.
A human life is sacred. It is sacred in its being born. It is sacred in its living. It is sacred in its dying. The sorrow and joy of life weave a tapestry of our individual lives as death gathers us once again into a blessed community. To bid one we have known and loved, farewell and adieu. To search for life's deepest meanings, to seek the comfort and the healing women and men offer one another, to say yes to life's greatest expression, love. Love believes all things, hopes for all things, endures all things. Love never ends. In the spirit of love, in the embrace of the ageless human community, we join our individual feelings and thoughts, as well as the faiths that sustain us, into a harmony of remembrance and affirmation. Today we must grieve Tom Peterson's death, but we must also celebrate Tom's life. Though our grief is strong and we must mourn, we will not let the shadow of death obscure the living person who touched us many times, in many ways, filling our lives with memories, meaning, and love. Let us be wise enough, and let us be brave enough today to remember honestly and to celebrate bravely a human life, the life that was Tom Peterson. It is good that we have come together because we need each other in empathy and consolation, and because we need each other in courage and wisdom to face Tom's death, to celebrate Tom's life, and to show our support for Tom's family, those who knew him best and loved him the most. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. God leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Death always brings us face to face with life. There is opportunity in this moment, and in this moment are the means to begin life again, though hesitantly, slowly at first. From this moment on, our living and our doing can be more loving and more abundant. This is one of the paradoxes of such an occasion as this, that it opens us to life and to love. Tom was always open to life, and he was always open to love. He loved life, he loved his family, he loved his friends and his work. But most of all, he just loved people, old and young, rich and poor, strangers and close friends. And in remembrance of the love Tom bore for humanity, let us listen to the words from the Gospel of John. Therefore, let us love one another, for love is of God, and one who loves is born of God and knows God. One who does not love does not know God, for God is love. No one has ever seen God. If we love one another, God abides in us and his love is perfected in us. God is love, and we who abide in love abide in God, and God abides in us. Let us love one another in memory of the love Tom bore to us and to all humanity. O God, grant us to see that only a few things bear the mark of the eternal: the beauty that lives with loving kindness, the transmutation of suffering into wisdom and understanding, the divine impulse given and received. O Spirit of life and love, give to us to cherish life's perishable beauty, that it may be imperishably present with us, and that we may so pass through the things that are fleeting as to become richer in the things that endure. And this is our special prayer. May they who knew Tom the best and loved him the most be comforted by divine compassion. May they find comfort in the community of men and women who grieve with them, who want to help and offer an ongoing compassion. May they find comfort in that which never dies but lives forever. Those things which seem never to change and which give us glimpses of the eternal. Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. Spirit of comfort and love, grant that this may be so for those whose grief is sharp and deep today. Amen. Our thanks and gratitude to the Mount Zion Baptist Church Choir for their inspirational music this afternoon. You know, whenever we used to ask Tom about these nasty weather systems we'd hear about on the news, and whether we should stock up on our groceries, he would most of the time sort of laugh and say, "These systems almost always miss Sioux City. They go around." And I think today we need to say, "Tom, you were right." One of the favorite memories that I have of Tom is a few years ago when my daughter, my son-in-law, and granddaughter were visiting. And we went to the community theater to buy tickets for a children's production. Tom was there, and I introduced him to my family and made some comments about the fact that my son-in-law was professionally in the theater and my daughter at least an amateur in the theater and in many productions. Tom immediately dropped whatever he was doing that moment and showed all of us through every nook and cranny of that theater, telling us the history and of his hopes for the future of the theater as we wandered around. I have no idea how long it took, but I know we saw everything there was to see. And I will never forget Tom's kindness and willingness to share himself with those whom he just met and might never see again, and his joy in sharing his love and pride for the community theater. And I was at that daughter's family when I got the news Sunday night. And they are mourning him as much as the rest of us do because of that connection. I also wish to remember Tom through one of his favorite quotes that was taken from Mark Twain Alive. And I think Tom lived this also. Quotes. "But the point I want to make is that you cannot reach old age from another man's road. My habits protect my life. They probably assassinate you. You have to make up your own rules and then stick to them. That's not as easy as it sounds, for there will always be somebody trying to reform you, trying to take all the pleasure right out of your life and replace it with dreariness. But don't let them. If you can't make it to 70 by a comfortable road, don't go." And may we now hear some remembrances from others whose lives Tom touched.
"You see, I don't try to be something that I'm not whenever I get in front of a camera. What people see is what I am." That's a quote from Tom in an interview that was conducted by Bruce Miller and published in the Sioux City Journal on January 2nd, 1980. Tragically, 14 years to the day that Tom was taken from us. In response to a caller's question, I said pretty much the same thing on KSCJ's open line this past Monday morning as they dedicated their program to Tom. But upon further reflection, I am convinced that's not the case. The off-camera Tom Peterson was a complex person whose life was supple and endlessly rich in meaning. But before being too hard on myself, I think it's only fair to point out how Tom responded to this question in another interview in another publication in 1984. When asked, "How do you see yourself?" Tom answered, quote, "Not very often, and then only in passing." But let's not be overly critical of Tom's self-analysis either. You see, he had a hard enough time talking about others who were close to him. In another article that I dug out of the file this week, I saw a quote where he was talking about his cat, Spike. He described Spike as nice, but didn't always have both oars in the water. I can't help but wonder how many times Spike must have thought the same thing about Tom. But let's come back to my reflected thoughts of just exactly who the off-camera Tom Peterson was and what it was he was all about. Tom did have his imperfections. As his boss over these last several years, I came to know many of them well. And in fact, I can't help but think that he's probably up there smugly smirking down on us this week as he's been elevated in a lot of anecdotes and stories to a point where he's almost been elevated to a point of being eligible for canonization. But the fact is that he was a rare breed. He was a person who could pose as a whimsical cynic, but who deep down in his soul was a believer in lofty ideals and in the perfectibility of society in general, and I think his home here in Siouxland in particular. And though he rarely, if ever, talked in such grandiose, if not flowery terms, his work and his life were driven by those beliefs. It's obvious to me now that the people of Siouxland were the perfect audience for his many talents, and he performed them with a fervor. We've been fortunate enough to receive hundreds and hundreds of letters in the past few days. Some of them are from people who knew Tom a long time, some are from people who knew Tom a short time, and many others are from people who never met Tom but thought they knew him well. I'm going to read just a spattering that I selected last night. Those people that I received letters from that I know, I'll share their name, but those that I didn't, I'll keep anonymous in the spirit of the privacy in which they submitted those thoughts to us. The first letter, in fact, is one that was written to Tom, and it was dated last week before his death, and we didn't receive it at the station until Tuesday. And it's typical of many of his life's works. It was just said, "Dear Tom, we wanted to tell you thank you for visiting our daughter when she was in the hospital at Marion Health Center earlier this year. She really enjoyed it and still refers to you as her buddy." Another letter. "Used to run into Tom at Holy Spirit Nursing Home. I guess his mom was there. My dearest friend in all the world was a retired doctor who was there also. We'd be outside in good weather. Tom would always stop by and say, 'Hi, Doc, how's it going?' He was a pallbearer at Doc's funeral on August 22nd, 1990. What a lovely human being. Aren't we blessed to have such nice memories of his kindness and humanity? Always smiled when I see his Cloud 9 license plate. So fitting. He is now no doubt, really among the clouds and stars." A letter I received this morning. "I knew Tom Peterson for only a short time, but it felt like I'd known Tom for many years. You see, that's the way Tom was. He was easy to get to know, and he was easy to like. He had that rare ability to connect with people and to make everyone he met feel special. Tom's time with us was far too brief, but his memory and our affection for him will live forever." From Spencer Christian of ABC's Good Morning America. Another one. "Once in a while, God sends us someone really special to show us how to be better people. He sent Tom Peterson to Siouxland to show us how to be ourselves, how to take time for others, how to be committed to community projects, how to laugh at ourselves, to be imaginative, to be genuine, how to share a warm smile and be a friend to all, and not least of all, a way to enjoy watching the weather with a sense of humor. One person can make a difference." Letter or note from Sister Margaret Wick at Briarcliff College, where they advised us that Tom had been inscribed on the honor roll of St. Francis at the college. And she writes, "It's so fitting that we include Tom in our honor roll of St. Francis because the characteristics of this saint for all people are service, caring, and openness to all. How can we better describe Tom Peterson? He is still with us, quotes, pointing, close quotes, the way to what is really important in life." Tom surely touched the lives of everyone in the Siouxland community, and we will miss him. A number of years ago, he helped us with a fundraiser for friends who were seriously hurt in an auto accident. The support he gave us will never be forgotten. A letter from Dr. Austin of the Sioux City Community Schools, who hasn't been in this community long, but I'm sure has heard from many others in the district of what Tom did. And he wrote to say, "I want you to know how much we appreciated the many hours Tom gave to the youth of Siouxland. Tom was a true friend of education. We will miss him very, very much." A letter from someone, a small town about 50 miles from Sioux City. wrote, I have a need to share my feelings. I never met Tom in person, but he was always a very welcome guest in my home. He was my weather person. He was kind, calm, and presented the weather with that twinkle in the eye. I never panicked when he gave me weather warnings, just the facts, ma'am, and was able to stay calm and follow his advice. Those summer storms always scared me. My life seems to have always had tension and stress in it. I came home to a renewed appreciation of what I had in Tom being my weather person. You see, he had a calming effect on me at the end of the day, after I dealt with the day's events and even the news of the day, which many times held sad news. This fellow Tom made a real wonderful difference in how I felt, and I will miss him very, very much. A letter I was heartbroken to hear, the sad news of Tom Peterson's death. Tom's labor of love as KCNU's MC for the MDA Telethon and his involvement in many of our other projects were instrumental in providing help and hope for literally thousands of people affected by neuromuscular diseases in the Sioux City area. So many will miss Tom, not just his family, his friends at MDA and his associates at KCAU and elsewhere in the television industry, but also countless others whose lives he touched through MDA summer camps and the many community projects that he could never turn down. His generous contributions of time, energy, and talent affected so many. I know he'll be sorely missed by all who knew him. It's from Jerry Lewis, the National Chairman of Muscular Dystrophy. And as Tom would say, down the home stretch here. Tom was a special person to us, even though we did not know him very well. We raced chuck wagons at the Clay County Fair in Spencer, Iowa, and one year we sent Tom a chuck wagon pointer. Darned if he didn't use it on TV and then call us and came up to the fair and rode in the wagon with my husband during the race. After Don got out of the barrels, he let Tom drive the horses around the racetrack. Crowd loved it. I believe Tom loved it just as much. I believe Tom loved it more than the crowd. Tom was a fine broadcaster and a real asset to the Sioux City community as well as to the broadcast industry. I know he will be missed by the viewing audience. In this world, there are some men who have the reputation of being, quote, big men. Not big shots with big egos, but big men, always there to help those in need without fanfare or seeking self-honor. Tom Peterson was certainly one of those big men. He will be missed. And that's from Don Brook, who runs a radio station in Sioux Center, Iowa, as president of the Iowa Broadcasters Association. And last, a letter that we had so many, there were a few that we posted at the front desk this week, and this was one of them. And it's addressed to the KCAU staff, and said, he writes that I'm only 11 years old, but I knew Tom. He always made me laugh. He had the best sense of humor. He would just make things fun. After I heard the news, I wondered why God would take someone like Tom Peterson to heaven. But now I think Tom, the city's best friend, is up there. He lived a wonderful life. Tom's life was filled with untold acts of extraordinary generosity, which, though the world rarely knew about them, the people we just heard from, and many people here today, will never forget. As pained as we are, Carolyn and Roberta and your family, and those of us with his extended family, are by his loss, we know that the achievements of Tom Peterson, the love he shared with you, his family, the unique way he communicated to his audience, the dream that he helped to make a reality at the Sioux City Community Theater, the good that he did, are legacies that will endure and will live on forever.
I'd like to thank all of you for coming today. I was a personal friend of Tom's. We got to know each other when I first moved to town in 1979. I'd like to first of all thank Carolyn and Robbie and the family for giving us the opportunity, and myself as a spokesperson for the community theater, for expressing and celebrating and giving tribute to Tom for what he has given us in the community theater. I do so with dignity, with sincerity, with celebration and happiness, and with also a degree of humility. Speaking for the community theater, my involvement compared to Tom's and others, as the French say, is un peu. It's small, because it's a big family. And we have celebrated and we have enjoyed Tom's participation and we have benefited. And that is what we'd like to pay tribute to today. Last time I worked with Tom was with the World's AIDS Day. It was at St. Luke's Conference Room about 4 weeks ago. I had the pleasure personally of working with Tom numerous times, as all of you and many of you have done. I knew no matter what went wrong, he would salvage it, and we could always have a repartee or something could happen that we'd bring it back on sense and back on key. It was always a pleasure. One of the funny stories is we bought a new house last year. Actually, it's a used house, as I told Tom, and it does have a pool. And I was busy moving in, working in the backyard, doing lots of things, and Tom came over to say hello. Before I knew it, he was in the pool. He actually had used the pool and a lot of other things in my house before I did. And we were thankful for that. He was throwing the kids around. But my primary involvement with Tom and my first knowledge of Tom was with the community theater. And so I speak to that today. Tom had a vision. And the vision was the community theater. He always had that theater vision. We feel it was his labor of love, and it was a natural labor of love to our benefit. Because Tom was theatrical. He performed all the time, whether he was doing the weather, whether he was plugging somebody, doing the tremendous numbers of services in the community, and it was a natural fit. But Tom provided leadership. One of the things about leadership is doing the right thing when you're called upon. Whatever the task was at the community theater to make it survive for the past years, Tom would do. Whatever had to be done to keep it alive, he would do. No matter what the obstacle. It was refreshing. You know, you'd scratch your head, do we have a problem, can we go on? And he would go ahead and we'd do it. And we would get it done. And he would enroll everybody's help. That is, by definition, the role of leadership. And he gave us that, and he gave it to us generously. One of the stories about the community theater, which a lot of people don't know, we've had a big renovation project over the last 5 years. But that renovation project was on hold because when you looked at the theater, it wasn't much for an asset, except for the human development and giving in it. And the banks wouldn't really bankroll, and rightfully so, all of our development that we wanted to do. We didn't have that. And Tom worked diligently and found a way. He found anonymous donors, door to door, hour to hour, day to day, for over 6 months, to co-sign notes privately, and these people are anonymous and they will remain so. But nobody else would have done that except for Tom. And we wouldn't have the renovations and the quality of what we have today. And listening Tom pitch these people was interesting and a pleasure all the time. Well, that was his labor of love. But Tom had other qualities that we have enjoyed at the community theater. The one quality which has been stated before, and the most important one, is Tom had a love for people. His labor of love was the theater, but his true love was people. He always accepted everyone. He brought the best out in everyone. When there's differences, we had a way of resolving those. He had another quality along with his love for people that goes hand in hand that we see in happy people and people who are glad to serve. He was not a selfish person. In his heart, he was filled with generosity. He never wanted power or title. He did all these things in our community because he loved us and he loved people. And he wanted to see us all succeed as a community. And he gave this in the community theater. He wanted us all to succeed. The third quality that Tom had that we see is energy. Nobody could do more, give more time than Tom. His energies were immense to the community theater. He came to every opening show, stayed late to close the theater, called on anybody we wanted to know. Heck, I can see Tom opening this notebook here. He had a notebook and take out and he'd chew his pencil and he'd write down, I'll do this, I'll do this, I'll do this. And we'd look over, where are you putting all that, Tom? You're gonna get all that in a day? And somehow or another, he did. He'd go out and get donations. But the energy was immense, and we have been the benefactor of that. And for that, we celebrate, and we're happy, and we pay tribute. There is another strong quality that involved you and me about Tom, and that was acceptance. That's why Tom felt comfortable in our community, while he enjoyed each and every one of us. Anybody that came to the community theater and had something to give, he could accept. If some of the rest of us kind of were at odds, he could see the good in the other person. He accepted it. If you were going to sing for the community theater, that was great. If you were going to make costumes, that was great. If you were going to take and put up the stage, that was great. If you had money to give, that was great. It didn't matter. He brought and he accepted everybody. But this level of acceptance was, Tom, was a two-way street. Each of us that is in the audience today, each of us that has known Tom, looked at Tom and the values that he gave, the ability to speak, the ability to give and get donations, to support the telethons, be the flock master for the duck race, all these rubber ducks, for the Child Protection Center in Marion, to go all the county fairs. He did and exemplified the values that you and I truly believe in. He lived those values. And I think each and every one of us saw that. And we identified with that. He had the talent to do it besides. He had the happiness. He had the ability to talk. He had the ability to express himself and the energies to give. And we accepted it and he knew it. I know he knew it. And he liked it. And it was great. With Tom, he also would give credit. And if Tom was here today, he had the degree of humility to know that things are not successful, no matter how great one individual and the power of that is, that you must thank everybody and those people. So with a sense of doing what's appropriate, I would like to thank you for Tom. Tom was happy about a lot of things when I was president of the board, and we talked about people and things. He was grateful for the donors. And he would like to thank the donors to the community theater that have given money, put the plaques up. He would like to thank all the actors for what they have done and the productions of the theater. He'd like to thank John and Rick for the play that they wrote and made a successful Christmas play a couple years ago. It was well accepted and he was very proud of that and he was thankful for that. He'd like to thank all the board members who have ever served, that have given something to the community theater and to his love and to his project. So take a thanks. He'd like to thank all the people who have made junior theater and lifted children's lives in the theater and made a better theater. The hundreds of children now that come through the junior theater. So those of you who are involved in the junior theater, that have given it direction and leadership, thank you. Tom would like to thank Randy and Ann for their work in keeping the theater up, bringing forth the business aspects of the theater. He was proud of what you do and what you have done. So thank you, Randy. Thank you, Ann. And Tom would like to thank the production board. The production board, for those of you who don't know theater, and I'm one who has learned also, is the driving heart of the theater. It makes the selection of plays, it puts on the productions, it does the stage, does the advertising. The production board has done an immense job, and Tom would want to thank every member who has ever been a member of that production board. And Tom was proud, and he was thankful, we talked about it, to have production board people now also be president of the board of directors, to see that grow together, that there be a conversation. You all deserve a lot of credit, and Tom would want to thank you. So I thank you. With all the thanks to the people in the community theater, though, we would like to pay tribute. It is with great honor, it is with great sincerity, that the Sioux City Community Theater, though, is Tom Peterson. And we graciously and willingly pay that tribute and look forward to our future. It is Tom's theater, and we're happy to celebrate and say thanks for that, and to honor Tom. He was the mastermind, he was the pusher. He has taken us where we are today. Now, all since Sunday, I've rolled around in bed, and I've thought at work when I'm working in the microscope, and I said, this little voice keeps coming on in my head, Greg, Tom loved an audience. Tom loved a theater. Tom liked a big group of people to talk to. Tom's love was the theater. If you ever want to honor Tom, come out, buy a ticket, buy a membership, and when you sit down in that theater and you bring your friends, you tell them what Tom did, and when you see his picture out there, and you have given it to Tom Peterson and a very worthy cause, and he thanks you. I give you God's blessing, and I sincerely thank you for the time of being here.
Dear family and friends of Tom Peterson, it's become evident to me, Dr. Galloway, that some of Tom's schmoozing techniques have rubbed off over the years. I'm struck with the thought as I came out onto the stage this afternoon that I want to believe that Tom is somewhere up above looking down on this memorial service today. And I truly believe that it's probably off, he's sitting on the real cloud nine, Ray. I want to hope that that's it. I think that he would approve of this service because anytime, Tom was really happy anytime that they could get this many people into an auditorium. And I remember Tom, I can see him in my mind's eye, I guess to use that cliche, of his smile, it was ever present, no matter where he was when he was among us. I think that's one of his hallmarks. If you didn't know about it before today, you have heard at least in the last few days, if not this afternoon, that Tom was very deeply committed and involved in our community. And as such, I'd like to just share with you that Tom was a very longtime member of the Sioux City American, or Sioux City chapter of the American Interprofessional Institute. And its memberships have shortened that name up just to call it Interpro for ease of speech. It's a diverse group of professionals in the community from varying backgrounds, disciplines, from medicine, law, the clergy, social science, the media, that come together every single Friday to have lunch, to listen to a presentation, and to have some discussion, provided a forum for its members to have some good discussion, point-counterpoint discussions, And Tom has shared with me, with his involvement over a long time in the organization, that he really appreciated being involved, that he was very satisfied being a member of that organization. In fact, Tom was to be our incoming vice president for 1994. And because I spent so much fellowship on Fridays over the years with Tom and got to know him, I found out he was a little bit predictable. I would like to think that he was late or the last one to come in, usually for lunch, because of his involvement in the community. And as I think about it, Tom always asked the most provocative questions. He gave you the sense that he was very well read on a wide variety of subjects, and that he brought with him some personal knowledge of issues because of his involvement in the community, and that added a lot. And when our group would get into some real heated discussions on some issues, be they political or social or educational in nature, Tom would bring just the right amount of comic relief to kind of bring us back to reality, to let us know that we don't need to be too serious about things all the time. I know you and all of the members of Interpro are missing Tom, and we're going to hold him in our memories and dear to our hearts for a long, long time. Because Tom was so active in our community, and because he's moved on quicker than most, he's left a void in our community, which you're all sensing, and that is he's left some work undone. And I don't know of a more fitting tribute for all of us to honor his memory than to become involved in the community in some way. If there is some issue out there that you believe strongly in, get involved in it. As I've talked with Tom's friends over the last couple days, both one-on-one and in some groups that I've been with, it's become real apparent to me what Tom's life work really was. And I'm convinced that that is to improve the quality of life for all of the people in Siouxland, and I mean all. I believe that that is the legacy of Tom Peterson. And you can help commemorate that through your involvement in the community. Tom, we're all going to miss you.
My association with TP goes back to 1977, about 4 months after he had started at Channel 9, I was hired. And when I think back about him this week, excuse me, nearly all the recollections that I have of Tom make me laugh. And I'm going to share some of those with you today. A lot of times, Tom and I, in our brief time during the news together, wouldn't get into very much conversational topics. Those were reserved for our trips, when we would go to Spencer to do the news, or Norfolk, or somewhere on our way back, or two. We would talk, and our topics ranged from TV news to the theater, his Vietnam days. We just spent a nice time talking about that not too long ago. And all those trips were enjoyable except for one. I don't know how many of you in this room have ever flown in an airplane piloted by Tom Peterson. I have. Once. We flew to Spencer, the Clay County Fair. Tom got mileage for an airplane. I don't know how he did it, but he did. And my fingernail marks are still on that plane. The Spencer Airport, the ground there, I kissed 5-10 minutes. We went to the Clay County Fair, made our appearance, and then I had to fly back or walk. And of course, he was all the way, oh, isn't this a beautiful day? Oh, the wing's a little dippy over there, and now it's back. Isn't this great? God was looking out for that guy. But what you saw on the air from Tom Peterson was the genuine article. I don't believe that I've known somebody who was less pretentious or more common than Pete. He says that he had a little Irish imp in him. I think it was more than just a little. He was proud of his Irish heritage. He'd always talk about the Manleys. But some of the qualities that have already been spoken about Tom's promptness. Every night on the news, the production people can vouch for this. Tom's idea was, why should I go out and sit and wait for the weather to come when I would rather just appear when it's time? Well, he was never out there more than 30 seconds before the weather. And I had my stock line. We're ready for the weather, but Tom's not ready for us. I had to use it twice. But he would come flowing in at about 30 seconds to air. And it's hard for me to describe this, like a ballerina flowing. So there was no time for them to set the chroma key shot to make him appear in this elaborate chroma key setup that I won't attempt to tell you about. So then we would start the weather, and he would just normally be putting his microphone on, and we would have our little conversation, of which I never knew what he was going to say. And then he would stand up, and as the camera focused on the map, Tom would start to empty his pockets. Have you ever seen Beaver Cleaver on Leave It to Beaver? Tom would get out his brains, his date book that was about as big as a Bible, lay it down, there would be a comb, there would be keys, and of course, the raffle tickets he sold for the community theater and resulting $15, $30, $40 in bills. Then he would walk onto the set. Well, the weather's half over. That didn't matter to Tom. The station must have thought we looked a little ratty at one time and wanted us to get some new clothes, so they sent us out to a clothing store for Tim, Seaman, and I, and Tom to get new clothes. And we were to pick out a suit, and Tom picked out his and came back, and I picked out mine. And one day, I turned to him, and Tom, are you here for the weather? And he looks at me and he goes, nice suit. I looked at him and I went, nice suit. They were exactly alike. Now, when we would wear those together, we would simply laugh through the entire 3 minutes of weather. And I think middle age was catching up with him a little bit, or else our newscasts were getting extremely boring. Because after the weather, Tom would prop it, and Tim can vouch for this, Tom propped his feet up on the desk, right under Tim's teleprompter, and would go to sleep. He would doze. And the first time, I thought he was just kind of kidding, and I'd shove him a little bit. At least he didn't snore. At work, anyway. I don't know how he was at home. As Ray has said, that the people who have contacted us since Tom's passing have been extremely kind, and there are a couple that I want to share with you today because they're indicative, I think, of how the community felt about Tom. This is a handmade card, handmade paper. These are tough. From Aurelia, little girl in Aurelia. Her mother wrote us a very nice card, and this is the end of it. Even my children were touched to hear that their favorite weatherman had passed away. They made the cover of this card with a large sun out of recycled paper. As we know, he cared about the environment, and the sun will never go down where he is now. Forecast is always sunny and bright. And then this hits home, too. This is from a young lady from Aurelia. All his pointers led him straight to heaven. Touched all with love from the forecast he'd given. Rays of sunshine he'd send with laughter, clouds filled with hope of better days after. Tom touched our lives in special ways by cheering us up on rainy days. Rainbows of promises he'd lay on the line, now reporting from heaven on his own cloud nine. But of course, as we've heard here today, Tom could be very serious too, and I must admit, and even though our relationship was, as I say, most based on humor, I gained a great deal of admiration for his courage and his compassion. He was a board member of the Iowa Civil Liberties Union. Human rights and the rights of all of us were very important to Tom. He had this vision of him being a hippy-dippy weatherman, but he wasn't. He had a great sense of what was right and a great sense of fair play. And my admiration really peaked when a while back, and many of you will remember this, there was a gun control policy meeting in Ottawa, Iowa. Tom was interested in gun control. He favored it. He hadn't gone to speak to this meeting. The meeting was filled and dominated by those who disagreed with him. And finally, Tom said he could take it no more. And he rose to speak, and he stated his case very eloquently. And he was the only one willing to get up to talk about that. He did so knowing what consequences could possibly come out of that. He was a very well-known individual, could bring criticism upon him and where he worked. The issue was so important to him that he did it anyway, and I admire him for that. He did it because his life was so much more than just being on television and being a weatherman. And I can't tell you how much I admire having the chance to work with TP. Then there's Ricky. Tom's high school classmate, Ron Girard, called Tom back in 1987 about this mentally challenged man in his 30s named Ricky, who lived at Parkview Homes. It was Ricky's birthday. He idolized Tom, as so many kids did. And he had special permission at the home to watch Tom's 6 and 10 o'clock weathercast. He never wanted to miss one of them. Now, Mr. Girard invited Tom to attend the birthday party for Ricky that year, and Ricky loved it. He was so excited that his hero had come to his party. Not only had just come, but had brought gifts. The next year, without being asked, Tom again brought Ricky a gift on his birthday. And he brought him down to the station. Mr. Girard is no longer at Parkview Homes, but he says that Tom has never forgotten Ricky. Every year since then, Tom has brought Ricky a gift and brought him to Channel 9 without being asked. Today, Ricky and I have something in common. We have both lost a very dear friend. We thank God for our time with him. His unique sense of humor was present in everything he did, and it was infectious. This past Monday, Lori Furlong asked how I would describe Tom to a total stranger. I think I said he was gregarious and loved life and was the ultimate optimist. Since then, I've given that question some more thought, and the answer she heard, although it was correct, left a lot to be desired. There were just too many facets of his life for a one-sentence description. Tom did so much for and gave so much to this community that I seriously doubt if any one of us here knows the full extent. Of course, we all know his broadcasting work, which led to his efforts for such things as the Rivercade Auction and the Muscular Dystrophy Telethon. Most of us know his long association with the Sioux City Community Theater, and how he spearheaded the recent remodeling campaign. Some of us know of his work with the ICLU. Some may know how he loved to visit school children. Others will know how he delighted in visiting with the elderly. Some others know of his sponsorship of a Vietnamese friend for American citizenship. Many of the things he did were well publicized. And most of the things he did were known simply because he was recognized by almost everybody. And that was a double-edged sword, because although he appreciated the audience and the larger forum with which KCAU provided, he also enjoyed anonymity. We spent some time together in other states over the years, and
and he relished in being just another person on the street. And perhaps that's why a portion of his service here in Sioux City was done anonymously. I'm aware of some sizable donations to the community theater that only two or three people know about. I can only guess that there were other contributions to other organizations and other causes that remain known only to a few. But that was his nature. He wasn't seeking accolades, only results. And Greg, we must have had the same scriptwriter in a sense, because I too can think of very few people as unpretentious as Tom, and particularly in his line of work. That's not to say that either his broadcasting or theater colleagues are pretentious, although he certainly can be, and it's not to say that Tom wasn't a showman, because he certainly was. I think we had to know him pretty well to really know him, though. That unique sense of humor was easily misinterpreted, and his lackadaisical approach to everything in life betrayed his true commitment. But his motives were always simple, they were always sincere, and always with the best of intentions. He and I disagreed on probably as many issues as we agreed upon. We both felt the other was misdirected on a number of occasions, but we respected each other, and we agreed to disagree. Our conflicts were more of a debate than an argument. A few people here today have witnessed those disagreements, but what you didn't see were the two of us several hours later drinking beer while listening to some obscure folk music and discussing politics. And with his and my political philosophies being about 180 degrees apart, those are probably discussions you should have seen. Those late nights and early mornings when we let what hair we had down will be among the best memories for me. For those of you here today who may have known Tom only through television or a chance meeting at a local store, what I'm about to say may seem crass, but it's not. Those of you who knew him well will understand that Tom himself would have considered this assemblage here today an excellent opportunity for a fundraiser. I think he would have been delighted to have us sell raffle tickets at the door for admission, and I'd venture to say that most of you in this room bought some from him. Wherever he went, he was selling the theater because it was the love of his life. And the theater is a much better place for what Tom has done, and we thank him for that. As is often the case with an unexpected death of a loved one, we realize now, too late, that we should have thanked him more while he was alive. With that, I'd like to thank Carolyn and Robbie for establishing a memorial in Tom's name at the community theater. And I'd like to thank Ray and Greg for directing donations our way also. I've been asked by countless people this week about the intentions of the theater regarding the memorial, and I feel I would be remiss not to mention it. At this point, I'm not sure what will be done. A meeting of past presidents and the current officers will be held next week to come up with some recommendations to be made to the board of directors later this month. An announcement will be made at that time. I've talked with Carolyn and Robbie, and they're providing input on the most fitting way for us to remember their brother. As only one of 15 people that will make the decision, I can't say what will happen. But I can guarantee that it will be appropriate, and that it will be commensurate with the tremendous contributions Tom made to the theater. At this point in my speech, I think you would probably want me to tell you of the upcoming shows. I'm not going to. But I can hear him saying how he would like to see you out of the theater and sell you a membership. Oh, you already have one? Well, get another. Give it as a gift to a friend. It was hard to say no to Tom, but some people did, and I find it ironic that those who didn't sample the theater or those who didn't contribute to its remodeling during his lifetime might just do that now. It's unfortunate that he won't be here to see that,
but at the very least, his wishes will come true. And he was the ultimate salesman. As Ray said the other day on KSCJ, he was a tough negotiator, and he really was. He could twist your arm so tightly, yet so ingratiatingly, that people didn't ask how or if they could help, but how often they could help. And it appears he still has the power to do that. Now, excuse me, now is the time that has been set aside to remember Tom, but many of us will remember him forever. And we all need to remember him in our own special way. There are times we had in Minneapolis and Memphis that I'll never forget. They wouldn't mean anything to you, but they're the essence of our friendship. Remember him in your own way, and remember him fondly, because he was not only your friend, you were his. And now back to the beginning. Lori, I still don't know how to answer your question. Tom Peterson was so full of life, so robust and unique, so zealous in his convictions, so eager to help, and so much a part of our lives that he defied description. In short, he was indescribable. He was just Tom. And to quote him, he's just a treat.
Hello there. My name is Tony Adelman, and I'm one of Tom's nephews. And for those of you who know our family, I'm one of Robbie's brats. I wanted to get up and say a few words because I feel like I had a special and unique relationship with my uncle, one that affected me in the most profound and really wonderful way. Looking back over that relationship these past few days has helped me make sense of this sense of loss that I'm feeling and my family is feeling, and certainly the community of Sioux City is feeling as well. But let's go back. The year was 1970. My Uncle Tom was at Morningside College, and I was 7. And like most 7-year-olds, my main concerns were playing hide-and-go-seek with the neighbor kids and watching Mr. Rogers, who was the 1970s equivalent of Barney. It was the weekend of October 30th, 1970. My family was in Sioux City visiting my grandparents, and they took me to a play that Tom was in at the Sioux City Community Theater. And the play was called The Impossible Years. Now, I don't recall ever seeing any plays before that date or aspiring to much of anything. I mean, Mr. Rogers had drummed into my little head, you can be whatever you want to be in life because you're my friend. But, I mean, I was only 7. Career planning wasn't something I had thought about often. Well, something happened that Saturday night at the community theater. Call it fate, call it karma, divine intervention, whatever. It hit this kid like a bolt of lightning. I was sitting in that theater, watching my Uncle Tom up there on that stage, making all those people laugh. I heard that applause, felt that audience-performer connection, and at that moment, I realized inside, I have to be doing what my uncle is doing up there on that stage. I have to be an actor. I was mesmerized, I was fascinated. The next day was the striking, or taking down of the set, which, if you've ever done a show, is a hideous thing that everybody tries to get out of. Well, I hadn't shut up since the night before about my new career revelations, so Tom dragged me over to help out at the theater. I remember the job he gave me was cleaning up the holes that they had been punched out of the tickets that were all over the floor with one of those push Sears Lee Kenmore things that didn't work. So I ended up down on my hands and knees on the floor, picking up each and every hole by hand. And I didn't care. I was ecstatic to be in the theater with my gregarious uncle. Time passed. My Uncle Tom went to Vietnam, and I didn't stop planning for my future acting career. Read every book on show business, saw every play I could, even had a theater company in my garage. Tom came back to Sioux City. He did more plays. The Silver Whistle, and Six Rooms Riverview, which, by the way, I also produced and directed in my garage theater, playing the part that Tom had played, of course, and if I do say so myself, my performance as a middle-aged New York married guy who has an affair in an empty apartment was brilliant. And think of it, I was only 12. More time passed. Tom became a fixture at Channel 9. I moved forward with my dream. In college, I landed a great part in a show at Dudley Riggs Theater called Night of the Living Bread. Opening night jitters were no problem for me, but the night my Uncle Tom was there, I was a mess. After the show, he told me how proud he was of me, that I had developed my talents, and that I should absolutely continue to pursue my dream. And let me tell you, after that, there was no stopping me. 7 years ago, I moved to Hollywood. A tough town to break into, but the past 3 years, my Hollywood career has begun to take off. True, pouring coffee and saying, "Telephones for you, Mr. Quartermain, at General Hospital," is humble beginnings. But I tell you, every single step of the way has been supported by a note or a phone call from my Uncle Tom saying, "Hang in there, keep at it, Tony." So I continue to keep at it. Tom visited me last September, and we brunched at Marie Callender's and talked all about life. He wanted to know all about a show I've written and hope to perform this year. Once again, he voiced nothing but total support and complete encouragement. And now, unfortunately, the voice is no more. People often say that accidents like these are a tragedy, and indeed they are. But what I think is a tragedy is if that person's voice is not carried on in the hearts of the people he affected. My uncle's wonderful free spirit and zest for life may be physically gone, but his reaching out to people and living life to the fullest lives on certainly in my heart and in my family's heart and in this community. And I think the greatest thing we can do is to cultivate and nurture that passion for life and for dreams that Tom shared with us. Utilize it, enjoy it, and in turn, share it with as many people as we can. That's what my Uncle Tom did. And in my book, that is the true magic of theater. And I think that's the magic of life as well. On behalf of my family, I want to thank you all very much for coming. Thanks.
Salvation and glory.
Death has brought us together. The death of Tom Peterson. Yes, but also no. Life has gathered us too. Life channeled through Tom's life. And love, life's purest expression which survives even death, has gathered us. Love for Tom, and love for those who mourn Tom's death the most. This moment is filled with the meaning we have brought to it through our shared grief, our shared memories, and through our concern and love for one another. We give thanks for the life of Tom Peterson. We remember him for the man he was, though we can only know a portion of his world. He lives on through all he touched, the common life of which we are all a part. He lives on especially through those whose lives were intertwined with his life. At this moment, we remember and hold in our hearts those who love Tom the most and feel his loss the most. His sisters, Carolyn Carpenter and Robbie Adelman. His nephews and nieces, those whom Tom loved as though they were his own children. Jeff Carpenter, Tony Adelman, Mark Carpenter, Robin Love, Rachel Carpenter, and Tim Adelman. May they be granted the gifts of wisdom, courage, and thanksgiving that will give them forgiveness, acceptance, and peace. And now as we say a final farewell to one we hold dear, let us be comforted and trust that a human life is full of purpose and meaning, even in death. For a human life is sacred. It is sacred in its being born. It is sacred in its living. And it is sacred in its dying. Please rise as you are able, as we conclude this service of remembrance and affirmation of the life of Tom Peterson. Humbly we stand in the face of death. Confidently we stand with life. Our strength is the strength of many. Indeed, it is the strength of all humanity throughout all time, because we share one fate and a great compassion. May understanding go with us and peace too, that we may live together in charity, compassion, peace, and joy. In this spirit, let us individually and together go forth to live and love. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. Amen.